sabotaged leadership, the nature of a pariah. In a world striving towards betterment and a fair stance on equity, some state leaders have deliberately chosen the sunken ship of deceit and inefficient leadership, thus placing followers or citizens in hardship. Pariah, in this context, is leadership plagued with structural fatalities, loopholes, and ineffective policies. A red flag of pariah leadership. The people have little or no say in the affairs of the state or a system or even an organization. The dictatorial attributes, God fatalism, and recycled leadership among same persons of similar interests at the expense of other persons in the system or the nation. Systems that are heavily dependent on caste and tribal ratings, we may call it prejudicial treatment of other persons in the system. These and more are the signs of a pariah leadership in any given community. A move to eliminate this system totally would be unrealistic, hence the need for fairness in leadership where good and effective policies outweighs the negative ones. Baby steps are what we need to approach this anomaly. Some of these could be intentional inclusion, equity to achieve equality, feedback approach, fairness and justice. Leadership should be about doing the right things in the right manner at the right time, respecting differences and seeking to share common value. By the way, pariah is about outlaw, outcast, ostracizing a set of people or a caste system, being partial in your dealings. So let's discuss this. So Victor, you know this issue of dealing with persons in the country, why some persons believe that they must only stick to power, power belongs to them. Mm. Why some persons have the opportunity to select the right people for the job, but simply because, oh, it's not from my tribe, oh, it's not from my religion, oh, it's not from this or that, oh, it's from a certain place that we don't deal with, and they will bring their persons, and these people will come in and cripple the system. So that's what we're facing, where systems are, our institutions are smaller than people. So what's your take on this, Victor?
Well, I've said this before on The Advocate, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts, absolutely. You know, and it's, I think, the part of intentional inclusion, right? I picked that from, you know, what you said. It's really important that we begin to ask ourselves, what kind of future do we want? I know, I mean, it's going to be really hard, right, to really, really evade this kind of system, the pariah system, right? It's going to be really very, like, practically unrealistic because of the way power is. And again, it stems from our values. What is the value of a Nigerian? You know, even within a tribe, people are still creating divisions. Oh, you're Igbo, there's this side of Igbo, and then in that side of Igbo, there's another side of Igbo. So there's a lot of, you know, so our values, there's a lot of, I mean, we don't have like a unified value system. What our value collectively, what unites us together? So one major joke can say is, I mean, what unites Nigeria is football. Because when you're playing football, after football, we're done. No, so but I think we need to redefine what is the value of a Nigerian. I'm not talking about the value of an Hausa or Igbo or Efik or Yoruba. What is the value of a Nigerian? And we need to strengthen those values, right? Because the truth of the matter, like I said, you know, earlier on, sometimes on the show, is it is the people that we are, you know, mingling with or talking with today that's going to end up in power, right? So but I think we need to really fix our value system. Like, I really don't even know myself, what is the value of being a Nigerian?
Yeah, okay. So, I know where we are at the university those days. Isaac, one of the values is living diversity. So what's your thoughts? Diversity is the spice of life, right?
Yeah. So first and foremost, outside that, I think getting people in position should be based on merit. So it shouldn't be based on if you're from a particular tribe or based on sentiments. That should be the same. It shouldn't be based on sentiment. So even if you're getting people, like you have, because once you start getting people involved based on sentiment, you are reducing the quality of people you get in that position. Mm. And in the long term, it will affect the system. Mm. So if you check in, I think that's actually what's affecting this nation. Because getting the rather for you to get people with the right skills on board, you're getting someone based on sentiment. And in the long run, you will kill that system. Because if you get someone who's not good into that position, the person, maybe before he leaves, you get someone to replace him, and that person who is replacing him may not still be that good in that position. So in the long run, we're all losing it.
Just before Ruth goes, sorry, just to buttress, you know, my talk on values. I mean, remember in secondary school, or even in primary school, I'm the class captain. I'm supposed to write names of noisemaker. Oh, I don't like Tokumbo. The way he's always looking at me. So you see, it's all forming.
Yeah.
Back. So when he answers, let's vote for the next assistant class captain. So people are raising their hands based on, he doesn't need to give me sweet in the bus when we enter bus. Are you seeing people already forming cabals?
Yeah.
So you're not voting Amaka because she's qualified to become the assistant class captain. You're voting Amaka because she gives you sweet on the bus. So we need to go back and fix that. It's a faulty thing and we need to fix it. It's part of our value system.
Speaking about class captain, I'm going to ask you one question. You know, when we were in primary school, it was class monitor. They used to call it class monitor. We got to secondary school, it was class captain and later prefect. Now, there's this popular person. I think if I'm going to quote her, I think Chimamanda. She said something that while she was in primary school, they never made her a class monitor in her own grades simply because she was a girl. And they said that the person that scored the highest, that performed very well in the exam will become the class monitor. According to her, then she and the guy had a tie. Now they gave it to the guy because she was a girl, and she confronted the teacher that she wanted to be. The teacher said, no, a woman cannot, or a girl cannot be class monitor. Now, the reason why I brought that out is, I'm going to relate it to you. You're a successful career woman, and I'm very quite sure your environment might be very good for you in terms of encouraging you to fight harder, push harder. It doesn't matter whether you're a woman or a man, you can do it anyway. But there are many girls out there that they desire to be where you are today, but they're in a wrong environment that keeps telling them that no, you're a girl, you cannot do this, you cannot do that. So what do you say about
that? Okay, so like you mentioned, I've been blessed, I've been fortunate to be in an environment where I've had people put me, I mean, regardless of my gender. In fact, my gender is not a consideration. Has never been a consideration. I know the work, that's all that matters. And I understand that there are women that do not have such opportunities like I do. So it's very important to actually think about those things. I think what can typically work in those cases, I mean, this is an advice for someone that has never experienced it, so it might be a bit theoretical, right? So, but what might really work in those cases, like in the case Chimamanda has actually set the standard, you know, you have to actually fight for your rights eventually. Because if we get to a certain stage in my career where I know that I would have to always fight for my rights, and I'm getting myself prepared for it, because I know that some people are not going to always give me that space. So like they say, I saw a quote that was put up by one of my respected person. She said, she said, diversity is a policy, inclusion is an intention. So you have to make conscious efforts as a business, as a person, to ensure that people are put into positions based on merits, regardless of whatever gender or tribe or religion they are from.
I like that. Diversity is a policy, it's good on paper, but in practical, inclusion is intentional. You're spot on. Well, the thing is, from what we've gathered, 2023 is coming. I hope Nigeria will learn to grow beyond our parochialism, religious sentiment, tribal sentiment, choosing who our leaders will be. Then also, within our reach, in our local businesses, in the corporate firm and the rest, let's respect everyone. Everybody cannot be like you, will not be from where you are. Respect people and just, let's stick to our common values, and then the system will work.
Well, time is never our friend on this program. However, the advocacy continues on our social media platforms, on Facebook, PlusTV Africa, hashtag TheAdvocateNG, and Instagram at PlusTV Africa, hashtag TheAdvocateNG. To catch up with our previous broadcasts, go to plustvafrica.com/TheAdvocateNG. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, PlusTV Africa. Till next week, same time on this station, let's keep advocating for a better society.